Pong is a super low level. That's the thing that you should be taking away from that. Quite literally, you had to just like resolder everything. If you had to change a component, you're reworking the entire system for this because it's all tied to one architecture. Fast forward to 2022, we got AAA games being written in libraries like Unity, Unreal, what have you, to do like Xbox, PlayStation, Steam, every kind of platform that exists out there. Plus, go play Elden Ring, it's awesome. No one bats an eye at this, that you can write a game in a tool and deploy it to all the different kind of devices out there, or different kind of game consoles out there, even PC. No one thinks that's strange, which is great. The game community kind of knows that this kind of cross-platform approach of developing is really good and that it's optimized for all these different architectures and they don't ever have to worry about it. They can focus on whatever makes their game great, which in this case is the first boss that will just destroy you. Mobile development right now is kind of, it hasn't caught up to the gaming industry. We have amazing devices in our pocket, super awesome iPhones, Pixel devices, I guess Samsung devices are cool. I was expecting more reaction from that. Either way, we have awesome devices that can just do so many things, definitely have more computing power than the original Pong, yet people expect us to develop like we're building for the original iPhone. We should be using super low-level technologies. We should be writing Swift, Objective-C, Java, Kotlin. That's just not really something that people should do. We have better tools, and we should be using them, because why? Why not? Why should we be writing super specific code for for single platforms? So what are those options? Well, my name is Mike Arrington, as Jeremy said. Thanks for the intro, Jeremy, appreciate it. Do DevRel at Ionic. You can find me on Twitter, at mhardington, and we're gonna talk about what those tools are. And this is going to be for a few developers. I'm going to try to keep it focused on just the Vue aspect for now. We are going to look at some Swift code. Does anyone know Swift here? A few people, so if I do something wrong, you're going to definitely call me out. You right there, I saw you raise your hand. Please keep me accountable for this. I need an accountability buddy. And if this demo goes terrible, you can definitely blame Jess, who told me to rewrite my entire slides for this. Go follow her, and if I do well, let her know. I had her permission to do this. She said yes. So let's go over. I'm not going to torture you by showing you Xcode. So we will do this in VS Code. So what we're going to be building is a mapping app. We're going to go ahead, try to get our location, try to track it over time, and build out all the infrastructure for that. So this is Swift. If you don't know it, don't worry about it. So we're going to come down here. So this is something really cool. It's called text. It basically just renders text. Go figure, right? Let's replace that. And we're going to replace this with a map. And it's going to get some coordinates, which we will define later. And then it should also show the user location. Now, if we go back to the top, we need to define what that region is, which is a private variable that is a state. And we will have NK coordinate regions. Inside of that, we'll have a center, which is a CL location coordinate region, 2D. Latitude, 41, whatever. Longitude, we also have that. We're just gonna do this, and it's going to work. Cool, we're gonna make sure that we aren't zoomed in too much. Here we go, that's our map. It's all working, right? Let's kind of just do the rest of this first, because this is going to be really, really important. So, I promise you, I'm doing this in real time. I played piano for like 10 years, so my ability to type is like super accurate. I promise you, I am doing this real. At some point in time, I did do this for real. All right, I'm actually getting bored of doing this right now, and. Come on now. Key repeat should have been up. Oh, this is so painful. Yes, this is terrible. What am I doing? Why do I have to do all this stuff? This is so much writing. Ah. Almost there. I promise you we're almost there. So other than that being very painful to just watch me match the keyboards, what we have here is this entire system to basically get a location on a map. Actually, no, we're not done. Now we're done. So we're getting all the location from a map. We have this state object, which is basically going to be our variable. We have a basically a view model. We have this thing down here called, where are we at? Content view model. It extends NS object, observable object, CL location manager delegates. We have a publish variable, which is essentially going to get us a way to read a value out of this, but then also subscribe to updates, and it's going to be managed for us, and it's going to be great. But then we have all of this stuff, and then we have to realize what delegates are, and I guess we could run it to kind of see what this looks like. Just for lulz, let's see. 13 Pro. And also, it was just really cool to see that you could actually deploy to iOS from VS Code, and you don't ever need to open up Xcode. Oh, it failed. Abort. Anyway, all that to show you that this stuff is super, super involved. We're now having to manage how the location gets updated. We're now having to go through and figure out how do we handle permissions, how do we do this, and now we have to go ahead and do this again for Android. Not fun. Again, nope, is that not my slides? Oh, is it crashing again? Oh, this is lovely. This is painful. Trust me, I can give a good presentation. Again, blame Jess. So we saw our Swift version. Very complicated. We're not even going to go into Android. It wouldn't fit on one slide. There are other solutions out there, though, for this. We could do something like React Native. I'm not going to shame if you do React Native, but this is actually not as much better because, yes, we get iOS and Android. It's a little bit more involved, and we don't have a web version. There are other options, too. We could write in a completely different language in a completely different environment, and this goes off the screen. This is all Dart, and it's super, it's not familiar to anybody. If you are a JavaScript developer, why are you going to look at Dart? We need something that's going to be one part native and one part web. Obviously, we need to be able to target all this, but trying to be as close to the web first and then being able to augment to get to native is going to be better. Ooh, animations. They actually played. Cool. So this is where our project capacitor comes in. If you've been to the booth, you probably have heard us talk to it, but essentially, it is a single platform for doing cross-platform development. We have a single API that will translate through all these different platforms. You first off just install a package and you have something that can target the web, but also Android and iOS without you having to know the stuff that goes on behind the scenes. The cool part is that this is also extensible through the third party. So if you want someone to have a SQLite plugin, and if you want to work with SQLite, you could. No one wants to work with SQLite. Very disappointing. But yeah, a huge community of people who are building all these extensive stuff. You could do stuff. We have a plugin for Sentry as well. All cool things. And you can use it with any JavaScript toolset. So if for some reason you're using Vue today and you switch to no framework tomorrow, still going to be able to use this. So it's pretty worthwhile to know. Let's actually go and do real live coding. And I'm not going to do it in VS Code because just because. I'm going to torture everyone with Vim, though. What we are going to do is deploy this to a real device. We have our simulator up here. I do have to select it. Give me a moment. Cool, so already we're doing stuff that you probably can't do, is running up a live dev server and just deploy to a real device. This could be connected through USB. Right now we're just going through the simulator. And awesome, our map is up and running, and we are looking at my hometown, so Providence. Let's actually look at how we can get this. So remember our Swift version here, right? A lot of code, a lot of management. We have to do so many things. Let's actually just open up our home component and get started with this. So the first thing that we're probably going to need to do is import from @capacitor, and we're going to import from geolocation. Geolocation is just going to be a little package that you can install. It's going to give you a geolocation class, which will allow you to access all the device features. There's other things too for like camera, Bluetooth, file system access, which is super cool. And I know Cecilia said to use reactive for objects, so don't be mad at me, Cecilia, but I'm gonna use a ref. Cool, I got your permission. Speaking of permissions, we now need a request permission to actually get the user's location. So inside of this onMounted, we're gonna create a function called request permission, if I could type. Now, this is just going to be a async function, so mouse request permission. It's going to be async promise you I know how to type. We will just say await geolocation not request permissions, and that's it. So why are you going to do this to me? I know why, because in the demo earlier, I actually had already accepted permissions. I promise you that's the case. We're just going to roll with it. Already had enough technical issues. Cool, so we have location. Let's go ahead and say await get location. Now this is going to be another function we'll make. So const get location. It's going to be an async function. And we will say const location equals await geolocation get current position. So this will do a one-time shot. So it'll manage making sure that we have the right permissions and making sure that we have the right services set up. And we can say location value value is going to be an object, and we will say our longitude or latitude is going to be lock backwards let's go to latitude and long and then we'll just reset zoom real quick to what 12? That seems right. Awesome. So now it thinks I'm in Apple. It's working really well. I'm happy with this. But in our other demo, it's able to actually track your location as it updates over time. So if I were to come over here and try to go to my features, I could say, let's go on a freeway drive. I'm going to miss out on all those events, and it's not going to work. There's another way that we could do this using the watch position method. So we'll say const tracking ref is going to be another ref. It will have const track location. We'll just call that. And then we can say geolocation or tracking ref.value is going to be geolocation.watch position. And then we have some options that we can set here, but we do get a callback. We'll do things old school and do callbacks because why not? Once we have that, we can literally just copy that, paste it down there, maybe just tell TypeScript that don't worry, those values will be there, and then we're done. And instead of getting location, let's track location. And it doesn't need to be. So now, as this is going, we can zoom in. And there we go, our map's automatically updating, and what do? How many lines of code is this? With the component and everything, it's 57 lines, and this is all the UI updating, all the permissions working. I could come over to the browser, It's also going to get the right position. Safari will block it because Safari. There we go. And of course, you can actually do this real cool trick in. Anyway, we're not going to focus on the browser. So all this is actually just going to work really well, and we can actually clean up after it if we needed to by clearing the location watcher. So all of this is now giving you access to geolocation in the browser on a device without having to know how that location service actually works, which is great. It's an abstraction. You don't need to know the finer details. Make sure that that's not going to crash one more time. We have options for other things. So if you want to, for instance, not use any of Ionic stuff, if you want to use, I don't know, Quasar, Beautify, your own Florida component, we have everything already in there, and that's just going to work on top of it. So as I said, geolocation is just one of those examples. We could do file system access, we could do push notifications, screen reader, share, all this cool stuff. It's really awesome. And then to build it, you're really just utilizing Vite, Vue, run your build, and then deploy. Happy you can be. So going back to the analogy, we don't need to do low-level development. You don't actually need to write Swift, Java. You don't need to do any of that stuff. You know JavaScript. That's enough. That is your higher-level abstraction. That's going to make you being able to write your own Elden Ring on the phone. If you want to know more about Capacitor, you can go to capacitorjs.com. And thank you so much.
So for any performance-heavy applications, what kind of considerations do you have to take? Is Ionic making use of the fastest low-level code for each device, or is it going to be a little bit slower because it's coding for all different things?
For the native access, so what performance considerations do you need to keep in mind? The native codes are all going to be fast as possible. For the biggest performance bottleneck is probably going to be your own code. Write fast code. I'm not joking. Make sure that you are following best practices in writing efficient code, writing efficient JavaScript, following all the best practices that Vue has, and you should be good.